Chapter 10, Summons Meet. Beach City, Crystal Temple. Naruto was sitting on the couch after taking a short break from helping clean up Steven's room after the whole incident with Hollow Pearl, and his mind was focused on what had happened since taking that attack for Pearl. "Hey Kurama," Naruto asked as he got the fox's attention, "do you remember what happened when Hollow Pearl had stabbed me? The only thing I can say, kid, is that a theory about you and your crystal gem power was right," Kurama said as even he was trying to figure out what had happened. "Unfortunately, even I can't remember what happened, so all I can guess is that you retreated into the gems. Then again, you were stabbed through the stomach." "Ow," Naruto mentally cringed, "Hollow Pearl had nearly killed me." "Yeah," said the demon fox, "but at least we know that you'll retreat into your gems if badly injured. Just don't do anything like that again." "No promises," Naruto thought back as he got up to help Pearl take out the collected garbage when he saw the boomerang in the wall. "Was that always there?" The room was finally cleaned after a couple more hours of using elbow grease and hard work when Yukon appeared in a plume of smoke. "The Pride King has sent me to inform Steven and our prince that the meeting with our allies will be commencing soon. Do not worry, the other lions and I will watch over the cub during the meeting, as the summoners of our allies will teach him about how to summon," said the silver lion. The other gems, Naruto, and Gamakichi and Gamadatsu waved towards Steven as the boy and the two lions disappeared in a plume of smoke. Aidai Taiyo Castle. Jiraiya was sitting on top of Game Ubuntu while using Chukra to keep himself from falling off the giant toad when he said, "I wonder how Naruto's doing since you told me that your sons had found him." Game Ubuntu continued hopping through the forest and said, "He's doing alright even after having a couple of close calls. The Gagi sure knows how to surprise anyone. Just don't expect me to just bring Naruto here." Jiraiya grumbled until he saw a massive stone castle in the distance. "Ah, Game Ubuntu," said Kakso in her giant form with Tsunade riding on her head, "how are you? I take it you can't wait to meet the Pride King? It's been quite some time since I last saw him." The giant toad chuckled as he said, "I wonder what Okaino wanted, since it's been years since I heard his son had gone missing due to a certain man." "Danzo," Tsunade thought bitterly as she could easily imagine who the toad was referring to, "you always seem to try and do things your way without even considering what could happen." The group reached the gates were too large, but not as large as Game Ubuntu or Kakso, golden lions stood. "Halt," said the lion on the left with a low, billowing voice, "state your names and reasons for approaching our great sun castle." Game Ubuntu and Kakso lightly bowed their heads as the toad said, "We, Game Ubuntu of the toads and Kakso of the slugs, have arrived for the meeting that the Pride King had called. We have also brought our summoners, Jiraiya for the toads and Tsunade for the slugs, as His Majesty requested." Both lions nodded before turning their heads towards the gate and let out a mighty roar. The gate opened to allow the two boss summons and their summoners to enter. The group entered the castle when the sound of something tropical echoed through the stone. "It appears the young cub is demonstrating his minstrel skills," said one of the lion escorts. "Our prince had mentioned our summoner's talents in music." This got Game Ubuntu's attention as he knew that Okaina's son had gone missing, but he decided to wait as the sound got louder as they entered the dining room. There, the group saw a small, pudgy boy with curly black hair wearing a red shirt with a yellow star on the front, blue pants, and red-pink sandals, holding a small guitar with a flame design on it, and sitting next to the boy was a lion with pink fur and a light pink mane. Tsunade and Jiraiya relaxed a bit as they listened to the boy sing while playing his guitar. "If you're evil and you're on the run, you can count on the five of us taking you down. 'Cause we are good and evil never beats us. We'll win the fight, and then go out for pizzas. We are the crystal gem. We'll always save the day. And if you think we can't, we'll always find a way. That's why the people of this world believe in Garnet, Amethyst, Pearl, and Naruto, and Steven." As the song ended, the many lions surrounding the boy lightly stomped their paws against the stone floor. "That was a good song, kid," Tsunade said as she and Jiraiya jumped down from their summons and clapped. Our escort wasn't joking when he said that you had talent for music. The young boy smiled with excitement as he said, "Thanks, I'm just glad that Naruto's alright after that incident." The two sannin were about to say something when a lion with silver fur wearing samurai armor coughed a bit and said, "Sir Jiraiya, Lady Tsunade, allow me to introduce to you the lion's new summoner, Steven Universe." Steven bowed towards the two adults and said, "It nice to meet you too, and I'm glad you liked my song." "It's nice to meet you, Steven, I'm Tsunade Senju," said Tsunade as she pointed to her colleague, "and this is Jiraiya. Please forgive him if he acts a bit perverted as he is an author of a certain series of adult literature." Jiraiya scowled a bit and said, "Hey, they're great works of literature. People love my books." "So Steven," Tsunade asked as her face held a serious tone, "you mentioned Naruto. How is he?" Steven set his ukulele to the side and said, "Naruto's living with us back home in Beach City. He's really cool. Seems like someone looks up to you, Naruto," Tsunade thought as she moved one of her ponytails behind her shoulders. "You always seem to leave quite the impression on people, Naruto." "So that's where the brat's been hiding," Jiraiya said with a chuckle. "How is Naruto doing, since he doesn't have any hands after that incident some time ago?" Steven looked at the toad sage and said, "Oh, he grew his arms back." "Impossible," said Tsunade with disbelief. "It would be near impossible for Naruto to just regrow a new pair of hands without help. I should know. I was the one who had to amputate them after what one of his former comrades had done to him." Seeing the saddened look on Tsunade's face, Steven placed a hand on the woman's hip and said, "Well, he did have some help from Kurama, and he even learned about his cruel bloodline. He's a crystal gem." Steven turned a bit green at the memory as Jiraiya asked, "Who's Kurama?" The boy quickly regained his color and said, "Kurama's the Kyubai." "The Kyubai?" Both sannin yelled in shock as Jiraiya then said, "That demon isn't to be trusted, as who knows what it could do to Naruto." Steven held up his hands as backup and said, "Take it easy, Kurama's a nice guy once you get by his coldness, and I swear that Kurama hasn't done anything to Naruto aside from helping him along with us train in the shinobi arts." Tsunade rubbed her temples as she thought, "Even when you're not here, Naruto, you're giving me a headache." A lion entered the area and said, "The Pride King would like to see Lord Gamabunta and Lady Kakso." Lord Safa had already arrived with his unique summoner, who is at the training grounds right now. "The rest of you are welcome to make yourselves at home." The two sannin let out a sigh as who this summoner was that the lion had mentioned. "Well," said Gamabunta as he and Kakso followed the lion, "see you in a while. Knowing Safa, this meeting will be even longer than planned." "Hold it," roared a new voice as everyone looked to see Asuma walking next to a monkey with white fur that was slightly taller than him, wearing a tiger-striped kimono with white fur trimmings over a black suit that had mesh cloth exposed on his hands and hand-like feet. "Monkey King Inma," the lion said threateningly as he gave a killing look at the intruder, "what brings you here? You do realize that you are a new and invited guest, and you know what we do to uninvited guests." Inma crossed his arms and said, "What is going on with this meeting involves not only Konoha, but a shinobi of Konoha." The lion looked at Asuma as the shinobi held up his hands and said, "Don't look at me, he dragged me here to be a representative for the monkeys since my nephew's too young." The lion looked at the bearded man and sniffed him a bit before he said, "I shall escort Lord Gamabunta, Lady Kakso, and Sir Inma to the meeting hall. You do your best to behave yourself, representative." After the summons left, a lioness with Egyptian blue fur wearing a mask approached the group and said, "Would you like to meet up with the tortoise's summoner?" Everyone nodded as they followed the lioness to the training grounds, where Gay was performing push-ups with a lot of shocked looks from many cubs and adolescent lions. "He's human, right?" asked one of the adolescent lions as the others right next to him were just as shocked at the sight. "How is he keeping track?" "And 1000. Said Gay as he stood up and dusted himself off before he saw Jiraiya and Tsunade. "Ah, Master Jiraiya, Lady Hokage, it's nice to meet you both here. Who is this youthful one and wise Asuma here?" Tsunade looked at the taijutsu expert and said, "Gay, this is Steven Universe, the lion's new summoner." "Steven, This is Mei Doge and he may be a bit eccentric, but he is one of our most respected Taijutsu specialists back in Konohagakure, and to answer your question about why Asuma is here, Gay, is that Inma dragged him so that the Monkey King could discuss something with the Pride King. Oh boy, Gay thought as he knew how temperamental the Monkey King can be, this meeting's going to be even longer now. Inside a large meeting hall, Gaima Bunta, Gatsu, and Inma arrived to see Okinayama and a small, human-like creature with seafoam green skin, an even darker green shell and shaggy blonde hair that covered half of the creature's face. Toad dude. Slug dude it. Said the creature with a wave of its webbed hand, "Ya finally made it. Why's monkey dude here? Why was that guy made the boss summon instead of his uncle, Ningame?" Gaima Bunta thought as he felt an oncoming headache before he said, "Greetings Safa. I see that you have finally been made boss summon," said Okina as he approached the giant toad, Swamp Breath. Gaima Bunta sneered as he said, "At least I'm still scrappy, furball." Okina snorted as he said, "So you have one scar where I have a lion with hundreds of scars. I recalled you cared too much about getting the ladies when we were much younger, wart face." "Oh dear," said Kotsu as she feared the possible fight, "please calm down as the meeting has. At least I didn't have to wait for years to get another summoner," Gaima Bunta said as he edged closer to Okina, "and if I recall correctly, you were just a pervert as I was back in our youth, Uroniko. Bug breath. Thug wannabe. Dudes. At least I can perform hand seals. Gaima Bunta, please. Well, at least I have claws and teeth. Brothers." Gaima Bunta and Okina continued to growl at each other, but much to Kotsu's and Sofa's surprise, the toad and lion then began to laugh. "Has it really been that long, Bunta?" Okina asked with a smile on his face. "Indeed it has been," said Gaima Bunta as he wiped away a tear, "old friend. We haven't had our usual greetings in years." Having enough of the unexplained laughter and confusion, Sofa then yelled, "Would one of you dudes please explain to me and Slug Dude it just what the two of you are talking about? I guess it has been a long time seeing as Gatsu-chan and Sofa are boss summons now," said Okina thoughtfully as he looked at Gaima Bunta, "considering the last time we got together was when you were small enough to ride on my head." The giant toad chuckled and said, "And you were about the size of Sofa here." "Well anyway," said Okina as his tone grew serious before he noticed Inma, "I do not recall inviting you here, Monkey King." Inma snorted as he said, "I invited myself here because your summoner says that one Naruto Uzumaki is living with him in this place called Beach City. Is this true?" Okina eyed the primate and said, "Indeed it is true, but what does my summoner's ally and Gaima Bunta's recent summoner have to do with this meeting?" Inma bared his teeth angrily as he said, "Because Naruto is a Konoha ninja whose loyalty is with Konoha, and since his banishment has been lifted, he is to return to Konoha post-haste." Letting out a growl and flaring his mane to look like fire, Okina said, "I believe that we should get on with the meeting, agreed?"
"Agreed.
Of course. Sure thing, brah. Whatever." Okina gave Sofa and Inma an annoyed look as he said, "I have called this meeting to announce that we lions are returning as we have finally found a summoner worthy of our contract." Gaima Bunta nodded and said, "Steven Universe, correct? My two sons, Gamakichi and Gamadatsu, have told me about him and how he looks at the toad's recent summoner, Naruto Jam Uzumaki, like an older brother." Okina looked at his best friend, but not without seeing the enraged look on Inma's face, and said, "Indeed. But it is sad to say that the lions are not going to be aligning with Konohagakure anytime soon." Taking a professional stance, Sofa then asked, "Why, lion dude? I feel like hiding in a wardrobe just to get away from not just this insult but that annoying monkey," Okina thought as he held an annoyed sigh. Asuma stood by at the side with Tsunade and Gai as Jiraiya and Steven stood in the center of the training ground. The Sarutobi Jonin did not like the looks on the lion's faces as an adolescent lion kicked up dust in his direction showed the shinobi that he wasn't welcomed. "Damn it, Inma," Asuma cursed the monkey summon, "why did you have to bring me along and not go alone instead?" I'm sure that since Kurama is training you and the others the ninja arts, Jiraiya said with a bit of reluctance, I'm sure you know the many hand signs that ninja can use, correct? Steven nodded as waved his hands and performed a substitution with a nearby training dummy before switching back. Ah, substitution, said Jiraiya thoughtfully before he continued the lecture, okay, since you know the signs it won't be much trouble. All you have to do is use a little bit of your blood, perform the signs, and then plant your hand on where you want to summon. Watch. Jiraiya bit his thumb before weaving his hands as he said, boar dog bird monkey ram. Summoning jutsu. Jiraiya slammed his hand on the floor and in a plume of smoke, Gamakichi was there before the two. Hey, Jiraiya, Steven, said the small toad as he nodded towards both of them. All right, said Jiraiya as Gamakichi hopped to his side, give it a shot. Steven nodded before biting his thumb, cringing a bit, and weaved the signs. Here goes, said Steven as he slammed his palm on the ground, summoning jutsu. A plume of smoke erupted and lion appeared before Jiraiya, startling the toad sage. Wow, said Jiraiya as he was impressed, I see you have a hang of chakra control. Steven chuckled as he hugged lion and said, well, Kurama hasn't taught me water walking and only lets me train on tree climbing with his or Garnet's supervision. This is lion, he's my familiar. Lion bowed as he then said, I am honored to meet the toad sage. I am Taiyo Oji. Prince of the Lion's summons and familiar for Steven Universe. I see that he's comfortable with you calling him Lion, said Jiraiya, normally it's not allowed as it's demeaning. Lion smiled a bit and said, while that is true, Sir Jiraiya, I am comfortable as Steven here has been my friend since I found him in the desert. I was wary of him at first, but I soon found myself attached to him, some may see me as a pet, but I consider myself a close friend. Tsunade gently smiled as Lion gave Steven a lick while Gei had tears running down his cheeks. To see such a connection between summoner and familiar, Gei said as he sniffled at the beautiful sight before him, is so youthful. Why am I so unlucky? Asuma thought as Gei had somehow created an ocean sunset behind himself while Tsunade face-palmed at the sight. With the boss summons, Sophia gulped after listening to what Okina had told them about Naruto and said, dude. That's not right, brah. Gamma Bunta nodded and said, when news of Naruto's supposed death reached us, it had actually saddened me to hear that he had died in such a way. I decided to look at the contract and I was surprised that Naruto's name was still active although I couldn't reverse summon him. I guess that the Gaki was too far away or somewhere that chakra didn't exist. So what happened afterwards? Sophia asked as he was sitting cross-legged, I mean. Did the village send out a team to go look for the little dude? Gamma Bunta shook his head as he said, when I told Jiraiya about Naruto still being alive, he thought of having Tsunade send some teams to go look for him. I then told him that it wouldn't work as Naruto was outside of the elemental countries, making some means of tracking him near impossible save for the old-fashioned way, ask around and pray that the lead is true. I've never seen a man so disheartened. Okina nodded in understanding as he said, it is never a good sight to see a strong summoner so disheartened about someone close to them. Hashirama was the same way when his wife had the Kyuubi sealed into her. So what are we going to do now, bras? Sophia then asked as he reached for a large leaf and took a bite out of it. Well I for one am going to take Naruto back with us. Said Inma as he took a few steps before the boss summons. Naruto belongs to Konohagakure as he is its shinobi. Gamma Bunta shook his head as he said, I don't think that would be wise, Inma, Naruto has finally found a place where he belongs and we cannot just take him away from that. Okina nodded as he added, I agree with you, old friend. Konohagakure seemed more like a prison than a home to the blonde as the scouts and sphinxes have revealed that there are still those who would wish death for the boy. My summoner could also use some extra training from Naruto and the Kyuubi as the life of a crystal gems is never one of simplicity. Bah! Said Inma as he crossed his arms, a ninja's life is even harder as they can die instead of being cowards and hiding away in those pathetic rocks. A loud and powerful roar echoed through the room, shaking the castle, as Okina said, you dare insult not only the respected crystal gems, But my summoner as well as his mother was also a crystal gem before she gave up her physical form to bring Steven into the world. Wanting to avoid a fight, Gatsu said, "But what about the people who care for Naruto-kun? Do you not think about how badly they would miss him? Tsunade-sama had told me the many times her apprentice, Hinata-chan, seemed so distant with her crush on Naruto on her mind. Even Gai's own apprentice had fallen out of his normal character for half a month after Naruto-kun's banishment. See, Pride King," said Inma as he challenged Okina, "you are not only keeping Naruto from performing his duties as a shinobi, but you are keeping him away from those who truly care about him, instead those cowards who are probably thinking of using him." "That's not what I was going for," Gatsu thought as she wished she had hands so she could face palm herself. "I know that the crystal gems would never do such things to Naruto, as they love him, with one of them just happened to adopt him as her son while another shows desire for him, which he also shows desire for," said Okina as he was starting to lose his patience with the Monkey King. "I am not going to do that, as it would also be against my own summoner." "Your summoner couldn't even last even a single year in the academy or even his first mission outside of this beach city," Inma said as he remembered seeing the small boy. "He doesn't even look strong enough to defend himself." Finally having enough, Okina let out an even louder roar as he said, "I have had enough of your tongue, monkey. First, you rudely shoved yourself into a meeting that you had no business with. Then you suggest we take a boy who desperately needs family and love and put him in a place that would rather see him suffer even after his death. Finally, you had the gall to insult my summoner who is still just learning the shinobi arts. This I will not tolerate. Now, before I decide on something I may regret in the future, we shall take a vote on how to handle Naruto Gem's situation. I vote that the cub shall stay with the crystal gems for my stated reasons." "I second that," said Game Abunta as he was disappointed with Inma, "not only because Okina is my friend, but I too believe that this is what the boy needs. If we take him away from that, we would be no better than that warmonger, Danzo." "I agree with Game Abunta and Okina-sama," said Kotei. "While I may not know much about Naruto-kun, but I do believe that this will help the boy, as I believe that the crystal gems along with Universe-san will remain true to being Naruto's friends." "I can't believe this," Inma said as he threw his hands in the air. "I had expected this from Game Abunta, as Naruto Uzumaki is the toad summoner, but you, Kotei? I vote that we take the Uzumaki back to Konohagakure, as the boy knows viable secrets that belong to the village. He even had access to the forbidden scroll at one point, so what else aside from the shadow clone jutsu? I assure you, Inma, that Naruto Gem does not know any other secret aside from him being not only the Jinchuriki of the Kyubai, but being the son of the very man, the Yondaime Hokage, who sealed the fox inside of him," Okina said as he got an appalled look from the monkey. "You told him who his father was? The boy's not ready to learn that secret," Inma shouted. "He wasn't supposed to learn that until the boy had turned 16 or made Chunin." Turning to Sofa as the boss summon was remaining quiet, Inma said, "Well, Sofa, what do you say? You're the boss summon for both the tortoises and the turtles since they got tired of the confusion summoners have made between them. What do you think should happen with the Uzumaki boy?" Sofa gulped a bit as he was beginning to get intimidated by the monkey as he said, I don't know. Monkey dude does make a point about Naruto possibly knowing more and being the Jinchuriki of the Kyubai, but what monkey dude is suggesting is gnarly, and not the good, awesome gnarly, and I can't really do that to the little dude." The kappa was feeling nervous as he just became a boss summon for both the tortoises and turtles, and while he knew that he couldn't be his usual self and surf the many waves of life, he wasn't expecting this. "Old man, Tobbs," Sofa thought as he silently asked his father and his idol while feeling the expected eyes of his fellow boss summons, "what do I do?" A couple of hours of waiting, everyone stood in the dining area as the boss summons appeared. "We have come to a decision about Naruto Gem Uzumaki," said Okina as his voice grabbed everyone's attention. "The cub will be staying with our summoner, Steven Universe, and the crystal gems instead of returning to Konohagakure. Mind you that this is for the best interest for the cub, as this was agreed in a 4-1 vote among us. Jiraiya, Tsunade, Gai, and Asuma were disheartened by the decision as who know when, or even if, they would get to see Naruto again. I shall also announce that while the Lions will be returning and helping Shinobi of Konohagakure, we will not be aligning with Konohagakure until otherwise noted, Okina added as he looked at the four Shinobi before him. No surprise there, all Konoha Shinobi thought as there were still people who wanted Naruto's head on a pike. You may now take your leave, Okina finished before returning to his chambers. Hey, Steven, said Jiraiya as he held a small package with a note, think you could deliver this to Naruto. At least for us. As Steven took the package into his arms, Tsunade also approached and said, I would also like this note delivered to Naruto as well. The slug Sanin handed the boy a folded letter. Could you also tell Naruto that Lee and I send our regards and hope that his flames of youth still burn as bright as they have been, said Gai as he was walking alongside Sokka. I'll make sure he gets them, said Steven as he memorized everything, farewell. As the two Sanin rode on the boss summons, Tsunade could help but ask, did we do the right thing, Jiraiya? The Toad Sage let out a sigh as he said, I'm not quite sure about your decisions, but I know that I should have done better for the blonde. I was spending too much time with both my research and my spy network, using up the Gaki's hard-earned money, but worst of all, I wasn't even there for him when I was supposed to be. I honestly think that Orochimaru would have done better than I would, at least the Tom would have been there for the boy, even though for possibly the wrong reasons. Tsunade was a bit surprised at her colleague's tone, but then again, was she any better? Beach City, Crystal Temple. Steven and Lion had returned to the temple thanks to the help of Yuken, where they saw Naruto and the others enjoying some pizza. Hey, Steven, said Naruto as he placed a slice on a plate and handed it to the smaller boy, how were things at the meeting? Steven took the plate as he said, well, there was an uninvited guest and what sounded like a bit of trouble, but everything had worked out all right. Okina and a few others decided to let you stay here with us. Everyone smiled as Steven then asked, so how were things here? The four were quiet as they looked at each other before Naruto said, not much really, just a slow day, that's all. Steven looked and saw a blush form on Pearl's face, Amethyst trying to hold her laughter, and Garnet's ever stoic face. Don't worry about it, Steven, said Garnet with her stoic tone, it was just a normal day. Steven shrugged his shoulders before handing Naruto the package and running outside with Amethyst following him. Naruto let out a held breath as he said, thanks, Mom. I'd rather not have to talk about that to Steven. Pearl composed herself as she then said, yeah, it was bad enough that the whole ordeal just felt weird. No offense, Naruto. Garnet looked at the two and said, you do realize that Amethyst may tell Steven about her day. Both Naruto and Pearl paled before rushing out the door and calling out to Amethyst and Steven, not noticing a chuckle escaping Garnet's throat. She wouldn't really tell Steven about that accident, said Gamakichi with a smirk on his face, would she? Garnet smiled as she said, Amethyst isn't really like that. I thought it would be funny to mess with those two a bit. Both the Toad and the Gym gave each other a high five at the prank, knowing that it was going to be fun with Naruto around. Well, that's the ending of that chapter. I do hope you enjoy this video. If you like to see more, remember to hit that like button, subscribe to this channel and leave a comment down below. Until next time.